Praise the Lord. This is Pastor Killingsworth coming to you today. I want to welcome you to church, remote service, First United Pentecostal Church of Groesbeck, Texas. We thank you for joining us today. This is a very unusual service for us, but we thank you so much for joining us. And we ask that you just allow God to reach down and talk to you today and minister to you throughout this service. It's going to be a little bit different today than what those who normally attend here would be used to. Hallelujah. But we're having remote services today like many are across this nation due to COVID's concerns. And so because of that, you can have church right in your home. The Lord said, where two or three gather together in my name, there shall I also be in the midst. We are privileged to be able to gather via the wonderful gift of technology that we have. We may not be in the same room, but we're sharing the same God and the same presence of God. So if you want to shout amen and hallelujah, go ahead and do so. It's mighty fine with us. Even right in your own home, it's okay. We're glad you joined us today. Amen. We're going to go to the Lord in worship right now. Why don't we just pray and ask God to touch us before we do that? Lord, we thank you, God, for everyone that is viewing this right now. We thank you for everyone who is watching this, Lord. I'm asking that you go from here to there, Lord, that you would touch them in their home, God. Lord, that you would just reach out unto them, Lord, and minister unto them, God. Whatever their needs are, Lord, we know that you are a God who is able to fix it. You are a God who is able to bless and to minister right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. We thank you for all the things that you have given us. In Jesus' name, God, we pray. We want to say amen, hallelujah, and hallelujah. Shame tried to tell me, keep looking back. Guilt held me captive to the pain of the past. Regret tried to whisper, you had your chance. Satan's a liar, and I know who I am. I am saved by the blood of the Lamb. I'm free, and I've been born again. I'm forgiven, child of the King. There ain't no shame on me. No, 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 no shame on me. Fear is a coward, doubt is a thief. And worry can drive you straight to defeat. There is a promise He's given to me, yes. The battle's been won and He's my victory. I am saved by the blood of the Lamb, and I'm free, yes. I've been born again, I'm forgiven, a child of the King. There ain't no shame on me. No, no shame on me. I am unworthy, so undeserving. I'm nothing without Him, I know. He's broken every chain, wiped away every stain, and He washed me whiter than snow. And I know that I know that I know. Yes, I am saved by the blood of the Lamb, and I'm free, yes. I've been born again, I'm forgiven, a child of the King. There ain't no
shame on me is. No, 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 no shame on me.
This is Pastor Killingsworth again. We want to come to you today and say to Sister Barbara Cooper, happy birthday. Her birthday was yesterday. We sure do appreciate the Cooper family in our church, and we want to thank them for being a part of our church. Sister Cooper, I hope you had a wonderful birthday. May the Lord richly bless you. Amen. Let's join together in song one more time.
He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. Oh, how he walks with me. Oh, how he talks with me. And oh, how he tells me that I am his own. You know my name. Yes, you know my name. You know my name. You know my name. You know how you comfort me. Oh, how you counsel me. And it still amazes me that I am your friend. And you know my name. You know my name. You know my name. You know my name. And oh, how you walk with me. And oh, how you talk with me. And oh, how you tell me that I am your own. And no fire can burn me. No battle can turn me. No mountain can stop me. Cause you hold my hand and I'm walking in your victory. Cause your power is within me. No giant can defeat me. You hold my hand. No fire can burn me. No battle can turn me. No mountain can stop me, cause you hold my hand and I'm walking in your victory, cause your power is within me. No giant can defeat me, cause you hold my hand. No fire can burn me, no battle can turn me, no mountain can stop me, cause you hold my hand. And I'm walking in victory, cause your power is within me, and no giant can defeat me, cause you hold my hand. Yes, you know my name. My name. You know my name. You know my name. And know how you walk with me. You know how you talk with me. You know how you tell me that I am your own.
Praise the Lord, everyone. So glad you could join us today. We're going to turn in the Word of God to Colossians chapter 2, verses 8, 9, and 10. Colossians chapter 2, verses 8, 9, and 10. And the Word of the Lord reads, "Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power." Amen. We have just turned our clocks from the much dreaded and much hated and despised year of 2020 and stepped into what we hope is going to be a better year of 2021. I want to carry you back over 100 years ago, well over 100 years ago now. It lasted 59 seconds, 1 second shy of a minute, but it gave birth to a century. Wilbur and Orville Wright made the first successful manned motorized flight near Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. And actually, they were a pair of professional bicycle mechanics. They were self-taught engineers. They made four flights on December 17, 1903. And the first was just a mere hop of 12 seconds. But the last was an 852-foot-long trip that lasted all of 59 seconds. And with that success, the air age began. That relatively simple biplane gave way to Sopwith Camels and Curtis Jennies to DC-30s and 707s all the way to Gulfstreams and Lear Jets and now Delta United, Southwest to massive airports like Heathrow and O'Hare and DFW. And it even led the way to the space program and paved the way for Gemini and Apollo missions, and allowed man to step foot on the face of the moon, and now to an international space station, and all because two men, two unlikely pioneers, led the way to a complete change in our thinking. Now, some of you may have seen film of the early attempts at manned flight with mustached gentlemen in their Victorian suits, they doing everything from flapping wing-like contraptions and pedaling belt-driven propellers and bouncing around ridiculously in useless gyrocopters. And we look back on them now and they're kind of amusing, but they weren't laughing back then. And people lost their lives in the search of the secret to flight. And the reason they look silly to us today is that we didn't understand the fundamental principle of flight. Today we understand that flapping and jumping and running and carrying on was useless. But it wasn't until the Wright brothers learned how to apply what is called Bernoulli's principle of pressure differentials using a curved wing edge that takeoff stopped looking like a circus act. And the course of human history was changed on December 17th, 1903 at 10:35 in the morning. And before that, those well-intentioned aviators could not have succeeded because they weren't dealing with reality. They had a faulty theoretical model and they couldn't get their contraptions to fly. Now, I know where I'm going with this, so hang on with me just a minute longer, amen? And every day, commercial airlines around the world carry about 3 million people. And most of those passengers, the most remarkable part of the trip is the in-flight movie. They don't even think about the most amazing principles of aerodynamics that are keeping them up in the air in a solid metal tube. Hallelujah. They don't understand the amazing principles of physics that are in place. But we understand that we owe an incredible debt to the Wright brothers and that single event that forever changed the course of history. It is an ironic footnote here in the story of the Wright brothers and their flying machine. When they finally achieved their dream, they telegraphed a message to their sister Catherine. They sent this message. They said, "We have actually flown 150 feet. We will be home for Christmas." Catherine hurried to the editor of her local newspaper, showed him the message, and he glanced at it and said, "How nice, they'll be back home for Christmas." But he missed the big news that man had flown. I've come to tell you, I know we passed Christmas, but somehow the world is missing the big news, and that is that Jesus came. It's not just that he came, but it's why he came. I'm not preaching a Christmas message today. I'm preaching a message on new beginnings. Colossians chapter 2, verses 8, 9, and 10 said, "Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power." Amen. I know at Christmas you hear sermons on the incarnation. I know you hear sermons on the baby Jesus. And the word incarnation is like the word rapture. While the words themselves are not found in the Bible, they are accurate theological expressions that capture valid biblical concepts. And in the case of incarnation, the English word is from a Latin root that means the embodiment of deity or spirit in earthly form. It is an endowment of bodily human nature and form, the act of being personified, if you will, and especially the union of divinity with humanity in the person of Jesus Christ. The word incarnation accurately describes what God did when he came to earth as the man Jesus. He was God personified in flesh. Jesus wasn't just part of God. He wasn't a second God. He wasn't a junior God. He wasn't a third of God, another God, or a subordinate God. He was God. Hallelujah. Amen. I was talking about this message to my wife yesterday and how I was going to be able to do all this. And she said, you can't say that you wish you had an amen corner, but I'm telling you right now, I wish I had one. Hallelujah. Amen. The Bible, I've got to tell you, is unapologetically and uncompromisingly monotheistic. Mono meaning one. Theos meaning God. The God we serve is absolutely and indivisibly one. All the names and the titles of deity in Scripture refer to the one and same being. And any time the Bible seems to associate plurality with God, it is referring to his attributes or his titles or his manifestations or his roles or his relationships to humanity or other aspects of God's self-revelation. But it is still one God. And this monotheistic view of central doctrine is central to both the doctrine of Old Testament Judaism and New Testament Christianity. Listen to the words of the Lord in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 and 5. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might." In Mark chapter 12 in the New Testament, verses 29 through 30, it says, "And Jesus answered him, the first of all commandments is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength." And this is the first commandment. The word Trinity is not found in the Bible, but most importantly, neither is the concept of a Trinity found there either. There is no passage of a holy two or a holy three. There's not a holy Trinity mentioned or referred to, but over 50 times we find the Scriptures referring to the Holy One. In Isaiah chapter 47, verse 4, "As for our Redeemer, the Lord of hosts is his name, the Holy 1 of Israel in Mark chapter 1 verse 23 through 25. And there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God." And Jesus rebuked him saying, "Hold thy peace and come out of him." Hallelujah. The fact is that God enrobed himself in flesh. He came to this earth and took on flesh. He took on the mortal. The immortality took on mortality. And it is one of the most wonderful and yet incomprehensible things about God. Jesus was like no other man. He had two natures. He was fully God and he was fully man. Hallelujah. And most problems in people's minds come around concerning the Godhead from this great mystery, because they cannot understand how he could be fully man and yet fully God. But 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 16 says this, "And without controversy great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory." I'm telling you, there's a great revelation when Jesus speaks of himself. Hallelujah. When we read a Bible statement about him, we have to determine if it's describing Jesus as God or is it describing Jesus as man. When we see a description of two natures with retrospect to Jesus, it is not talking about two persons. It is talking about the spirit and the flesh. As a man, Jesus was born a baby, but as God, he existed from eternity. As a man, he grew mentally, physically, spiritually, and socially. But as God, he never changes. As a man, Jesus was tempted by the devil, but as God, he cast devils out. As a man, he hungered, but as God, he was the bread of life and miraculously fed crowds. As a man, he thirsted, but as God, he gave living water. As a man, he grew weary, but as God, he grew rest. He gave rest. As a man, he slept in a storm. As God, he calmed the storm. As a man, he prayed. As God, he answered prayer. As a man, he was beaten. And as God, he healed the sick. As a man, he died. And as God, he raised himself from the dead on the third day. As a man, he was a sacrifice for sin. As God, he forgave sin. As man, he did not know all things, but as God, he knew all things. As man, he had no power, but as God, he had all power. As man, he was inferior to God. As God, he was God. Hallelujah. As a man, he was a servant, and as God, he was King of Kings. I'm trying to tell you who Jesus is today. This was the crucial era of the Jews when they rejected their Messiah, because there were two streams of prophecy that referred to his coming. One spoke of his deity and the other spoke of his humanity. But the Jewish leadership of the day could not reconcile the two. They could not understand how the Messiah could be so divine and yet so human. So they missed the Messiah that their very own scriptures prophesied about. And it's only in the New Testament that we see how God reconciled these two prophetic streams. The miracle of the incarnation is God's answer to the question. The life of Jesus is bracketed by two possibilities: a virgin's womb and an empty tomb. Jesus entered our world through a door that was marked no entrance. And he left through a door that was marked no exit. Modernists try to deny the virgin birth. Scientific knowledge may not be able to account for it. And spiritual ignorance can state that it's of no real consequence. But the biblical importance of it cannot be overlooked. And it cannot be overestimated. It was the virgin birth on which our Bible doctrine hangs. If Jesus was not born of a virgin, he was not sinless. If he was not sinless, then he himself could not be the Savior, but would need a Savior. Hallelujah. And if he cannot be our Savior, then the entire plan of redemption crumbles and falls. Because salvation depends on the incarnation. You may not agree with that this morning, but I come to give some scripture to back that up. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 says, "There is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Jesus Christ." Matthew 1:23 said, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which being interpreted is God with us. So the fact that he came born of a virgin was so important, hallelujah, that if it had not happened, he could not have been our Savior. The fact that Jesus was actually totally, fully, and completely the Almighty God is what we call the doctrine of one God. But why is believing in the oneness of God so important? What is my relation to the incarnation? What does it have to do with me? To put it simply, because without Jesus, we don't have the fullness of God to humanity. Without Jesus, we don't have a way to reconcile our sins. But because of Jesus, because God robed himself in the flesh, was born of a virgin, and laid in a manger, we now have a bridge between God and humanity, and we can experience the fullness of God in humanity. John chapter 14, verse 16 through 18, "And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But you know him, for he dwelleth with you." That's the incarnation. He dwells with you. And then it goes on to say, "And he shall be in you." That's salvation. Hallelujah. Jesus himself said in verse 18 of that chapter, "I will not leave you comfortless, but I will come to you." There's one thing, and only one thing, that made the incarnation of Jesus Christ necessary. Because we sinned, and therefore we came under God's eternal death penalty. We needed someone to redeem us. However, all of Adam's descendants would be born in sin. And because of that, they would need redemption for themselves. But in the Old Testament, no man was qualified to be a redeemer. And God's law dictated that every sinful man had to be redeemed by a sinless man. And since every man descended from Adam was sinful, hallelujah, no man here could redeem us from our sins. Only God was left to redeem mankind. The problem was that God was not a man. And the only way that God could redeem us was to come in the form of man himself, to be like us. But if God was to become a man, that man had to be without sin. Otherwise, he himself would be nothing but a sinner, unable to save anybody. Jesus answers with the miracle of the virgin birth, in which God clothed himself with a body of flesh, but did not inherit a fallen human nature. By the virgin birth, God brought a sinless being, Jesus Christ, out of a sinful being, Mary. In becoming a man, Jesus did not cease to be God. He was God before Mary was even overshadowed by the Holy Ghost. He was God from the foundation of the world. He was God when he was born. He was God after he was dead and rose. But through that virgin birth, the eternal God added to his divine nature a sinless human nature, and therefore became a God who was also man. Here is my relation to the incarnation. At the incarnation, God already, he added to his already existing divine nature, a human nature. Thank God that he did that, because it is through that nature that I found salvation. That we can add our already existing human nature, we can add to that a divine nature of God. Hallelujah. Listen, I'm trying to tell you this morning that the only way you're going to get to God is if you go through Jesus. He is God manifested in flesh, seen of angels. Hallelujah. He was witnessed unto. He was sinless, yet he was still man. Hallelujah. He was all man, and he was all God. How is that possible? 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 through 4, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 19, 20, and 21 says, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us who know no sin, that we may be made the righteousness of God in him. And because Jesus took on my nature, now I can take on his. Hallelujah. Our Lord, I love you this morning, Jesus. There's so much that I'm thankful for, God. I thank you first and foremost for your word. God, that word that lives and breathes, though I find it in the pages of your book, that holy word has breath and life and was made flesh, and I appreciate you for that, Jesus. I thank you for salvation today, God. Hallelujah, Lord. For those that don't know what it feels like to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, for those that don't know what it's like to be filled in the presence of God with the anointing, the presence, and power of the Almighty, and to feel their sins washed away, I pray, God, that you would reach down and touch them through this morning. God, we ask that you would grant these things, Lord, according to your word. And we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done, for your goodness, for mercy in you, Lord, we thank you. For God, we are, without you, nothing but sin and lost. But I thank you that you came not only to redeem us, God, but to show us the way. Hallelujah, Lord, and I'm asking that you allow this word to go forth. Lord, let it be received in a mighty and powerful way. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.